So thanks everyone for sticking it out for the last presentation of the night. I appreciate it. My name is Rebecca and I love to study cancer and chronic disease conditions. It's really my passion and I really hope that we can one day find a cure. I think about this stuff late at night. So how does cancer feed into diversity and health equity? Well, let's start out by talking about and recognizing diverse populations within our healthcare systems and how that can lead us to health equity. So first of all, for those of you that don't know what health equity is, health equity is a state in which everyone would have a fair and just opportunity to attain their highest level of health. It would work to eliminate any preventable barriers and health disparities, and it would value everyone equally across the board. So I imagine something where everyone in this room and everyone around the world would have equal and fair access to get good quality healthcare in order to attain their highest level of health and become a healthier individual. So how does health equity feed into getting a disease, a chronic disease like cancer, for instance? Well, first we need to really understand the pathogenesis of cancer and what feeds into this disease model to begin with. I always think of cancer as a very intertangled web of many different multifactorial things, which could be anything from our socioeconomic status to genetics. And each and every one of us sitting in this room right now, we're all genetically and uniquely different, which is really good. And we're also, because of our genetics, we may be at a higher risk for certain chronic disease conditions. In our country today, there might be food disparity that might feed into this disease model. Maybe patients live in an area where there's food deserts, where they don't have good quality access to food, and maybe it's really expensive to buy whole foods, or maybe they live in an area where there's a lot of fast food chains and it's just really convenient to pick up things on the go. Maybe patients live in an area where they work a high-risk job, where they're exposed to chemicals or environmental toxins, or maybe they have behavioral risks like smoking or even alcohol use, where they're exposing themselves to different chemicals in that sense. Perhaps they live in a geographical location. Maybe they live in a rural area or an urban area. Maybe the access to good healthcare isn't the best where they live. Maybe they live in an area that's highly polluted and they're being exposed to pollution all the time, or they don't have good quality access to water. All these things feed into the disease of cancer and the disease model. But what we need to do is recognize that there's different subpopulations of patients within our healthcare systems across the country. And when we recognize this, we can help better diagnose our patients. And we need to really become more aware of these social determinants of health and how we can better understand how to diagnose our patients and then the needs of our patients. And an example of a social determinant of health would be anything from environmental to like where we actually live, our housing, our social community and context, those that we interact with on a day-to-day basis, good quality healthcare, so healthcare access and economic status, and just all kinds of things that would feed into why someone might get cancer. And social determinants could actually feed into that, unfortunately. So let's just take a look at cancer rankings in the United States currently. The data only goes up to 2019. That's the current data that is out there. I just want to put a disclaimer there. That's why it says 2019. They do it in 5-year increments, so we're not due for a couple years where more data comes out. But currently, I want to draw your attention to the top rates of cancers, new cancers, within our country today. Female breast cancer coming in at number 1, followed by prostate cancer, and then lung cancer ranking at number 3. In this chart here, I want to draw your attention to the rates of new cancer deaths. We have lung and bronchus cancer at number 1, and then female breast coming in at number 2. So let's dig in a little bit deeper. Let's go on a more granular level here within Pennsylvania and look at the county level data. There's 67 counties within Pennsylvania. Now you could see the areas in the darker shaded blue, they're areas within Pennsylvania, those counties. It's a cluster where there's a higher rate of new cancers within this area. And that's actually a big area of, you know, where a good portion of the people live within the Northeast, within Northeast Pennsylvania. So what's happening? Why are the rates of cancer going up? And also, when you look at the data for breast cancer, it comes in at number one at the state level. So breast cancer is number one, followed closely by lung, and then prostate and colorectal, and then bladder. So those are your top five cancers for the state of Pennsylvania. Are we sensing a theme here with breast cancer and what's going on? I am. It makes me think, what's going on? As a cancer researcher, and I have a strong interest in this sort of thing. So our current state, I really wanted to dive deeper into the literature. I'm really sorry this is very wordy, but like the true science-y person I am, I have to present some literature and what's going on. I tried to pull the current literature and kind of dig a little deeper and see like how we could do better as far as getting certain populations of women in for our breast cancer screenings and trying to understand who might be at more risk and how we could do better and move forward with health equity. And the recognition of our diverse populations is our first step. So you could see here that breast cancer is the leading cause of cancer-related death for Black and Hispanic women per the American Cancer Society. A recent study came out by Herbert et al. From 2022, and it found those living in distressed communities have lower rates of screenings compared to those living in less distressed communities. That piece of literature also recognized the fact that those living in rural communities have lower screening rates compared to those living in urban communities. So maybe a lack of access to healthcare. Maybe people have to travel further to get to healthcare facilities to get their screenings. I also want to call out that within Black, Hispanic, American Indian, and Alaskan Native women, they get diagnosed at a later stage. Not only that, but there's a disparity between Black women and white women. So Black women, when they do get picked up at an earlier stage, when we're diagnosing them at earlier stages of cancer, which is good, that's the goal, they're coming in at a rate of about 54% in Black women are getting diagnosed at an early stage. But white women are coming in at a 64% rate. So that's also something to be very mindful of as our patients are walking in the doors and in the clinics. Also, Black women are getting diagnosed younger and with a more aggressive type of cancer. This cancer is called triple negative breast cancer. And they're getting diagnosed at a higher rate compared to other women from different racial and ethnic groups. So this really leads me to believe that are our bands of age ranges. So the United States Task Force has criteria for age ranges. You know, within certain age criteria, they should be getting, women should be getting diagnosed and picked up through mammography screenings. So maybe we need to make for certain aggressive forms, have women come in the clinic earlier to get their mammography screenings. So that's just something to be more mindful of and how we could really just work to get certain groups of women screened and being more mindful as they're walking in our clinic doors. I don't really want to be negative completely on this whole slide. I do want to look at the good work that is happening. There is some good news in all of this. Because of the great advances within breast cancer screening imaging technology, that has led to a reduction in breast cancer-related mortality. So that's really positive. And the cancer-related mortality is going on a downward trend for breast cancer, which is good. However, we really need to be careful and pay more attention to the at-risk populations that might be more at risk for triple negative breast cancer. So just because it's trending downwards doesn't mean that we're still, you know, in the clear here. So what does a future state look like, and what could we do to help in order to get all populations of women screened in order to catch cancer quicker and sooner so we can treat them sooner? So we really need to look at three different areas. One being at the primary care clinic level, and work to get our women preventative screenings. Not only that, but having informed conversations with our at-risk populations about preventative screenings. Not just saying you're due for an annual screening, we should get you in the clinic. No, you're due for an annual screening and you might be at high risk based off of your genetics. We really need to have those conversations with our women coming in the clinics. Not only that, but we can have outreach coordinators sitting within our PCP clinic levels that are actually making phone calls to our patients and offering the screenings and then scheduling them right then and there to come into the clinic and get screened. And working together with multidisciplinary teams and looking at the clinical workflows and not having too many touch points. This is where the system breaks down. So are we getting on the phone call offering the screening to our women, but then someone else is calling them and actually scheduling them? In a perfect world, we would really want the patient to maybe be in a one-stop shop kind of scenario where they're going into the primary care clinic, the physician's noticing, oh my gosh, you really need to get your screening done, and schedule them right then and there that day. And if they could go within the same building and get their screening right then and there, so they don't have to come back into the healthcare system and travel back and worry about how they're going to get into the clinic if they don't have a ride. So working to remove all these barriers that might be in place for people that haven't gotten screened yet. At the community outreach and local level, targeting outreach in the community and at the community level and at the county level, I showed you that map of Pennsylvania and where there's a higher rate of new cancers within that county cluster, I'll call it, maybe working within those specific counties and putting the word out about getting people their screenings. Would this look like handing out pamphlets at really big events? I'm thinking at some of the arenas around here, maybe when they have events, setting up a table, setting up shop as people are walking into the mall or to an arena, and having boots on the ground campaigns, and then having open and honest conversations with our patients and allowing them to have personal empowerment and autonomy in making decisions about their own health and wellness and keeping them informed so they understand why they need preventative screening. We may offer them screening, and so many times within our projects, I see patients will refuse because they just don't want to go in, maybe because of cost, because of the financial burden and the impact. How much is this test going to cost? So keeping everyone informed on the insurances and the United States Task Force criteria and those age range brackets that I mentioned before. And when you fall within a certain age range bracket for screening, it's covered. It shouldn't be paid. You know, it'll be paid for. You won't have to pay out of pocket for anything. And also trying to keep the cost of services down, which I know that could be a really tough thing to do, but believe it or not, the cost really impacts whether a patient will walk in the clinic or not, because they're fearful of getting a really big bill at the end of the month. So that's really tough too. So when we can recognize that there's so many different approaches and so many different ways we can work across our healthcare systems and work together in order to, you know, bring health equity to everyone across the board, and recognizing certain populations that may be genetically at risk, this will help physicians better prescribe those preventative screenings and recognize that example that I used with the triple negative breast cancer and making sure certain populations of women are getting their screenings. So I just wanted to end with a really good quote I always think of from time to time. If we knew what it was we were doing, it would not be called research, would it? By Albert Einstein. So I want all of you in the room just to think moving forward how we can bring diversity and health equity for, you know, and make great strides and bring everyone together in order to get the best healthcare. Because maybe one of you in the room might be that one person that saves another person's life by just recommending them to go to the doctor and get screened. And that's it. Thank you so much.